Good morning, everyone. So in last class, I had just introduced Ashtangika Marg, that is the Eightfold Path. Today, we'll be going through Eightfold Path. What are its constituents, and what are some of the core of Buddhism? So, the Eightfold Path, it comprises of the following. The very first thing is right vision. It is samyak drishti. So the right vision doesn't mean seeing things whatever you are seeing through your eyes. The right vision means to have a vision, to have a thought, okay, to have the complete or perfect understanding of something. It signifies perfect view or understanding of the nature of reality and path of transformation. This is what we understand by right vision. In order to realize that vision, one needs to have right thought, which means samyak sankalp. If you have a vision and you don't think accordingly, you don't understand accordingly, which might help you in achieving your vision, then it's of no use. So with right vision, you need to have right thought or attitude. Right thought or right attitude. It signifies having an emotional intelligence and acting from love and compassion. what does Buddhism teach us? Buddhism basically focuses a lot on compassion. You need to have compassion towards every other living being. This is what Buddhism is all about. So, right vision needs to be accompanied by right thought. Then, right or whole speech, which means samyak vak. What does this signify? It signifies truthful, clear, uplifting, and non-harmful communication. Okay, whenever you communicate, the communication should be clear. It shouldn't, your words shouldn't be like they are looking down upon somebody. They should be uplifting. They should uplift somebody's spirit who is already feeling low. Then that speech, it needs to be backed up by right action. Right action or integral action. What does that mean? Samyak karma. It signifies an ethical foundation of life based on the principle of non-exploitation, oneself and others. So, additionally, the right action itself, it includes 5 percepts or training rules, which are for which are necessary for the members of monastic order or the Sangha. We can further write, includes 5 percepts, or you can say training rules. Which are like an ethical code of conduct, governing the behavior of the members of the monastic order and even the lay worshippers. So the five precepts, they are as follows. The very first thing is Ahimsa. Don't commit violence. So it applies to all living beings and not just to humans. And not just humans. Why? Because according to Buddhism, all the living beings, they have the right to live. Their lives, and that should be respected. Okay. Second is, don't covet the property of others, which means to undertake the training to avoid taking things not given. What does that mean? So it goes further than stealing. as it preaches that one should avoid taking unless one is totally sure that it is intended for him only. Next is don't indulge in corrupt practices or sensual behavior. So what does this mean? To undertake training to avoid sensual misconduct. Which actually means covers overindulgence in any sensual pleasure such as gluttony, or misconduct of a sensual nature, so this is basically for monks, for the lay believers celibacy was replaced by chastity. Okay. then we have is don't speak a lie. Which means to undertake the training to refrain from false speech. What does this cover? It covers slander, lying, deceiving, and speech that is not beneficial to the welfare of others. Don't use intoxicants. Which means to undertake the training to abstain from substances which cause intoxication and heedlessness. So this percept is in a special category. As it doesn't infer any intrinsic evil in alcohol itself. But believes that indulgence in such a substance could be the cause of breaking the other four percepts. Okay, so apart from these five percepts which come under right action, the monks and nuns, they had to take three other percepts as well. Monks and nuns were supposed to strictly observe three other percepts. And what were they? The first one being to avoid eating after midday. Second, to abstain from dancing singing and other entertainment as well as to refrain from using ornaments perfumes and other items used to adorn or beautify a person. And the last one being to abstain from using high or luxurious beds. And from handling gold and silver. Which means gold and silver, that is including money. Okay, so this is the whole of right action. Next is right livelihood. Proper livelihood. Samyak Ajiva. It signifies a livelihood based on correct action and on the ethical principle of non-exploitation. So this particular thing, that is right livelihood or proper livelihood, this according to Lord Gautam Buddha, it formed the basis of an ideal society. That an ideal society, it should be formed and based on everybody following the right path of livelihood. Next is right effort or energy. Which means samyak vyayam. Energy or vitality. Signifies consciously directing our life energy to the transformative path creative or creative and healing action. That fosters wholeness thus moving towards conscious evolution. Next is right mindfulness. Can say complete or thorough awareness, which means samyak santati or samyak sati. So it signifies developing awareness about oneself, and keenly watching self behavior. So what exactly do we mean by this? That while getting aware of ourselves, we need to keep an eye on our behavior, on our actions, everything. When we do that, then only we become aware of ourselves. What are our strengths? What are our weaknesses? Okay, so Lord Buddha, he himself says that if a person holds himself or herself dear, then that person needs to keep an eye on himself or herself as well. The last of the Eightfold Path is right concentration or meditation. Which means Samyak Samadhi. So what does this signify?
It signifies Samadhi in the sense of
enlightenment. Buddhahood Samadhi literally means
to be fixed absorbed
in an established
absorbed in
or
established at one point. So we can say thus the first level of meaning is concentration
when the mind is fixed on a single object. Second level of meaning goes further and represents the establishment not just of the mind but also of the whole being in various levels or modes of consciousness and awareness. Okay, so this is what we have all about the Eightfold Path. Okay. I'm rubbing this. Now, one thing which is to be remembered which is very important in the doctrines of Buddhism, the path taught by Lord Buddha himself is often referred to as the middle path. So, what exactly do we understand by this middle path? The term right
right here
signifies
proper whole thorough
integral
complete and
perfect.
So basically it right as opposed to wrong.
Now two people have they can have different opinions, different thoughts regarding a particular aspect, regarding a particular thing. It doesn't mean that someone is right, someone is wrong. For example, if I write 9 and if somebody stands at this place, then it will look like 6 to the person standing over here. Person looking from this side, it will look like he will read it 9. Even the person looking from above, even he is correct. The person looking from below, he is correct as well. So people can have different opinions regarding a particular topic, regarding a particular incident. It doesn't mean that someone is right or someone is wrong. Both can be right. They might have differing opinions. So like as we all say, agree to disagree. Yes, you might be right regarding something, I might be right regarding something. We have different opinions. So let's agree to disagree. That is the whole principle about the right in case of Buddhism. Okay. So I will leave you till here today. We'll meet in the next class, and then we will finish the doctrines of Buddhism. This is it for today. Your next class will start in sometime 10 to 15 minutes. Thank you for today. Have a good day. Thank you.